In this interview, we talk about monitoring, Docker, and Kickstarter. How do you track errors in development, and how do you know when your users run into errors? Do you even have an error tracking strategy? Mine was terrible, but I found a solution that I really like. Rollbar is an incredible product, and I'm not just saying that because they're sponsoring the show, I'm actually using Rollbar at Scale Your Code. I'll tell you more about that later in this episode, but go to try.rollbar.com/syc and set it up with your app. It's really easy, it took me 5 minutes, and it works with any language and any tool you need. try.rollbar.com/syc. Hey fellow developers, my name is Christoph, and this is the Scale Your Code show. In this interview, we're going to talk about two very important topics that are really gaining in popularity, Docker and monitoring. With Docker, I really want to get a deeper understanding of how it works, what it is, and how we can use it to scale our applications. Similar thing with monitoring, where we're going to talk about how to get started with it, the right tools to use, and the right things to monitor. Now, in order to do this, I've enlisted the help of an expert. James Turnbull used to work at Docker and now advises them. He is also writing a book called The Art of Monitoring, which is due for release later this year. So we're kind of going to get a little sneak peek of it. And he's also currently the VP of Engineering at Kickstarter, so I'm going to ask him a few questions about that as well. James, I'm really excited to have you on the show. Welcome.
Thank you very much. Glad to be here.
So I've recently started reaching out to the community to get some questions, and I did this on Reddit with the past episode and again with this episode, and it was just really cool to see people come in and pitch in, and frankly, there were some really good questions that we got from it. So I do plan on doing that with future episodes as well. If you're interested in pitching in, then I do recommend that you follow me on Twitter. I think I'm going to start doing that as on Twitter as well, not just Reddit. And same thing with the email newsletter. So keep an eye out for that. I've been really happy with the questions so far. So James, in previous episodes, there's been a really big recurring theme when talking about scaling, and that is monitoring. You know, if you're going to have an application, you need to monitor metrics. And obviously, you seem to agree with that philosophy. And that's why I brought you on the show to talk about this. But from the work I've seen from you, sometimes you have a slightly different opinion of how monitoring should be at different companies and things like that. So what does monitoring mean to you, James?
So for me, monitoring is about and scalability is an interesting way of looking at it. Monitoring is about understanding how the systems and applications you own are providing business value. So a lot of traditional monitoring is about memory and disk and CPU and sometimes throughput or the number of 5xx errors on a web service. I think those are important, but they're sort of underlying capabilities. What I really care about is now, how is my application performing for my customers? How is it performing in terms of the volume of transactions, the rate of transactions, the quality of service? Is it responsive? Are users seeing errors, or are they having a good user experience? Things like that. So more of that sort of more meta level monitoring is where I sort of tend to start with thinking about monitoring.
So it's not just about the CPU usage, memory usage, it's also about the business metrics. And is that why you decided to write a book on monitoring, to share this thought here?
It's partially why. I don't think I'm the only, I certainly wouldn't claim to have sort of originated this idea. There's a lot of organizations that are sort of, who are much more sort of oriented around how applications perform and how they provide that service and that value. I was a couple of reasons I decided to write the book. One was I was interested in sort of articulating a different approach to monitoring, and the second was I wanted to present an alternative to sort of the more traditional sort of monitoring, which is sort of very large monolithic applications, things like Nagios and stuff like that. I wanted to provide an alternative viewpoint and present people with, like, here's some potential way, or at least a potential way you might be able to approach monitoring differently.
Sure. And you're currently working at Kickstarter. What does the monitoring look like at Kickstarter? What kind of tools do you use, for example?
Kickstarter is really interesting because it is it's very customer facing. It's very much aimed at our community. So we focus very much on metrics and application sort of state. So we care a lot about we instrument a lot of our code so that if something error appears or an unexpected behavior occurs, we get an alert on that.
And then we instrument our code and the surrounding system to determine
what's the throughput of transactions. Are people able to pledge money? Mm-hmm. The business components of the environment work. So we use tools like Graphite and StatsD. We use a proprietary bug alerting system called Honey Badger, which we're very keen on. We have tools, underneath that. So we also have monitoring tools like Sensu and things like that. But really, our primary focus is on, looking at graphs, understanding performance, and understanding application sort of behavior.
Mm-hmm. And that reminds me, when I was talking to Jeremy Edberg in my last episode, when he worked at Netflix, they talked about, it really matters to us whether our users can watch movies or not. So that's what they really focus their metrics on. Not so much the CPU, like you said, not so much the services, but can our users watch what we're selling them? And that reminds me of basically the same thing. So say you were starting an application like Kickstarter, for example, from scratch. What process would you implement to monitor from the get-go? And I'm asking this because username Cyrex007 says, I know the tools. What I don't know is how to get started with them.
Sure. So I would identify, what does the application do? What is its key sort of business proposition or its value? Let's say it's a web app. So I'm going to care about response time. I'm going to care about the throughput of any sort of transaction that's generated by the system or job that's run. I'm going to care about the user experience. So I'm probably going to start with instrumenting the environment to say all of the things that sort of the moving pieces that generate sort of events or transactions. I'm going to instrument all of those so I can keep track of the throughput of them, and then work out over a period of time how to trend it and scale and all that stuff. I'm going to instrument my front end in some way, my JavaScript and stuff like that, to identify, events and track people through the system, mm-hmm. Understand what their user experience is. At Kickstarter, we're very big users of events, and we're very big users of A/B testing. So we're looking at a backer comes to the site, they see a project, they back that project. What was their user experience? Where did they go? Can we identify ways of making that a better user experience for them? Let's say, can we get them to navigate to the place they want to go? Everybody wants to go to, say, this page, and it's now three clicks from the home page. Okay, let's make it one click from the home page. Mm-hmm. So that sort of stuff is really important to me. I would worry less about the sort of system level metrics until I sort of had an idea in place of what my actual application did and the metrics around its performance.
Mm-hmm. So what are the simplest tools that you would start out with, or is it really dependent on what you're trying to measure?
It is a bit dependent on what you're trying to measure. I think tools like StatsD is a really good example of something that's incredibly simple. And it comes with a huge collection of language-specific libraries. I mean, you can integrate StatsD in stuff that runs in the JVM, Clojure, Scala, Erlang, Haskell, Ruby, Python, Node, Perl, you name it. There's a StatsD implementation out there. I would include, some utility code in there that enables StatsD, and then I would start peppering my methods with, various StatsD calls, generate events, point them at a StatsD service, and then, suck it into something like Graphite, or Librato or one of the hosted services if you're doing things like that.
Mm-hmm.
I should say the other option is, of course, there are tools like New Relic. That's just a matter of enabling an agent and getting things running. They can also they can be pricey, but they're certainly a way of getting a head start on your monitoring.
Mm-hmm. And I do use New Relic as well for the application monitoring, and there is server monitoring. I know there's other ones like browser and mobile and things like that. So this is a question from username Kendall M, and it says, a popular approach to metrics is to build an in-house solution rather than using one, rather than using some commercial or open source tools. Do you think this is because there is some functionality missing in the commercial or open source world, or is it just that people don't know about the stuff that exists already?
So I think there's been sort of an evolutionary change in monitoring. When a lot of people originally started looking at monitoring, there wasn't a lot of good tooling out there. Mm-hmm. Certainly, there weren't a lot of good open source time series databases. Graphite was very young and very mature, and to be honest, the user interface still isn't awesome. So I think a lot of people did build things in-house. A lot of the open source tools just didn't scale in certain environments. Netflix is a prime example of this. Mm-hmm. I mean, they built their own tooling because, you know, that they operate a very, very large, complicated environment. Roy Rappaport made a joke at Monitorama this year that something, I'm paraphrasing him, but something along the lines of, Netflix is the world's largest monitoring systems. Oh, and by the way, we also stream video. at that sort of scale, you know, they had to build something themselves. Mm-hmm.
That makes sense. All right, so let's say that we do have monitoring and logging in place now. When you say that we watch for metrics, do you have dashboards somewhere that people keep a close eye on and they look for certain patterns? Or do you just set up some kind of notification system and, hey, there's a problem, you get emailed or it goes through your Slack or PagerDuty or something like that? How does that usually work?
We tend to do both. So we have a set of dashboards that basically show there's a sort of a central dashboard that basically shows the state of the site as a whole, like the key things we care about on the site that are probably going to give us some indication that something is wrong. Mm-hmm. And every time we deploy code, and we deploy like, you know, 5 or 6 times a day, somebody's basically watches that dashboard. The person doing the deploy watches the dashboard to make sure everything goes smoothly. But we also have individual alerts set up, some of them on metrics thresholds or anomalies, others on sort of code stack traces and things like that. Mm-hmm. And we also have very crude sort of monitoring alerts set up, things like ping them and stuff like that, just to make sure, like if our monitoring system fails somewhere along the way, we can at least tell that the Kickstarter site is down.
Sure.
Like sort of very meta level sort of things. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. So you just mentioned recently Nagios. Are you talking at all about Nagios in your upcoming book, The Art of Monitoring?
I'm not. So you may or may not know, I wrote a book called Pro Nagios 2.0 about, must be 10 years ago now, when Nagios was pretty much, you know, the state of the art. I don't see Nagios as overly changed in terms of sort of, there are a lot of things that have been added to the Nagios ecosystem, but broadly speaking, architecturally, Nagios is still the same tool it was, you know, sort of more than 10 years ago. I find that problematic, and I find the way it's configured problematic, particularly when we live in a very dynamic cloud-based world where instances come and go, and we have things like Docker and containers that are far more ephemeral. I don't think Nagios is an ideal solution for those sort of environments. So I don't talk about it in the book. I wouldn't call the book an anti-Nagios book. It's more about saying there are alternatives.
Sure. And there's a free sample chapter that you can download from your website. I'll try to link that up below the interview if people are interested. And the sample chapter talks about a tool called Rieman. Can you tell us a little bit more about why and what Rieman is?
Sure. So I talked a little bit about how the fact that I'm very interested in metrics and events. Rieman is a metrics engine. It's effectively runs on the JVM. It's written in Clojure. I describe it as a metrics and events routing engine. So basically, what happens is you run Rieman, configure it to receive events, and then various, you know, you can set up various sort of sources for events, like things like StatsD and CollectD, and even things like Nagios, or, you know, all sorts of things you can send events from to. Inside Rieman, you configure it to basically say, if you see an event that looks like this, take this action. Or if you see an event like this, you know, add up all the events you see like this and create a metric. Mm-hmm. And I think about it like a central nervous system for a monitoring system. So all of your data comes in, You work out what you care about inside that routing engine, and you route it off to, say, PagerDuty to alert somebody, or you identify something you want to keep track of, and you convert that into a metric, and then route it off to Graphite or some other time series database. Mm-hmm. And because Rieman is written in Clojure, its configuration is also articulated in Clojure. So it's effectively, its configuration is a Clojure program, which means it's incredibly powerful. You can do amazing things with Rieman, and things that are, you know, traditional sort of monitoring systems require, you know, considerable amounts of a fairly complex setup to do.
So you basically just run it as a daemon and filter through any events that pass through?
Is correct. That what happened? Yeah, okay. And it runs on the JVM and it's written in Clojure, it is very, very fast. There are people out there who process millions of events a second.
So why doesn't every tool take this approach?
I think for many people, I think there's obviously varying levels of complexity in people's requirements. Like, for a lot of people out there with a small number of hosts and a really not very complex system, you know, there are lots of very simple tools like Nagios that are very appealing. I mean, they take minutes to set up with. They're a little bit confusing and convoluted sometimes, but, you know, there's enough blog posts out there that, like, you know, have Nagios in 20 minutes or whatever. Like, Rieman is you know, I won't say it's hard to set up, but, you know, it is a reasonably complex animal, and it's a reasonably complex implementation and system. It does think about things a little bit differently from traditional monitoring systems, because it's very much about pushing events to it. Like, Nagios is a pool-based system, a polling system. So a central server runs or some sort of node runs, and it basically says, tell me what the disk space is, query that. Tell me, you know, connect to this HTTP connection and tell me what gets returned. Make sure this thing is running. Rieman assumes that you have systems out there that are pushing metrics and events to Rieman. It's not actually actively going out polling anything.
Mm-hmm.
And that, for many people, is a very different way of thinking about monitoring. And I think that does present some sort of challenges, sort of, in people going, you know, what do I do next?
Mm-hmm. And in the sample chapter, you talk about, you know, we just said there's a daemon running, it filters through the events, and it indexes those events, right?
It does. So Rieman is largely stateless in the sense that it's not a data store. So it doesn't automatically store all events for all time. It treats events with a time to live. So it says every event has a time to live that's been set on the system that emitted it, or is set by default when you hit Rieman, and that time to live might be, say, 60 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And it has a concept called the index. And the index is basically like the current cache of events, or the current sort of pool of events whose time to live hasn't expired yet. So what it does is it allows you to say, I want to look at events, you know, I want to have this index of events, I want to be able to keep track of them, and assuming that everything is still functioning, every time, you know, every period of time, a new event will appear in the index. So let's say you're monitoring something like a simple, like an Apache service. The Apache service, you know, some tool sends an event every 60 seconds to say the Apache service is running,
mm-hmm.
And that gets indexed. And when Rieman sees that, when that event has a TTL, let's say 60 seconds, it expires, and Rieman says, I'm going to send an expired event, and it shoots off an event. What happens there is that if Rieman sends that expired event, I mean, it hasn't heard from that service, and you can basically tell that, you can understand, you can then say, that service has disappeared, it's no longer reporting to me, there must be a problem, I should generate an alert. And you can take that expired event and say, send it to PagerDuty and say, Apache process on this machine has not sent an update for 60 seconds, that probably means it's not working.
I see, so that's how it's different from just polling instead of seeing if there's something expired. Okay. Is it good for distributed environments?
I think it's very good for distributed environments, particularly because if you think about the Nagios world, the polling needs to be told what to poll.
Mm-hmm.
And the Nagios configuration is still very much a bunch of big text files. And so essentially what you have to do is you have to say, every time a new host appears, I have to add my Nagios configuration for it, and then start monitoring it. In the distributed systems world, or in the Docker world, for example, containers might live for seconds. Distributed systems world, you know, clusters of nodes, some of those nodes in that cluster might last for a minute, some of them might last for 10 minutes, some of them might last for 30 minutes. if you constantly have to update that configuration and then wait for everything to converge before you can actually monitor things, that's not going to help you. Whereas if your machine, your instance or your container wakes up and says, ah, I'm a web server, mm-hmm. I need to start sending events to this instance of Rieman over here or this instance of this service. Rieman goes, there's a new thing. I will add the new thing to my reporting. The new thing has gone away. Am I supposed to tell people when a new thing goes away? And if it does have an alert, you know, it'll generate some alert. If it doesn't have one, like, for example, say I'm running Docker containers to run asynchronous jobs. I may not want to care. I may only care about the fact that my container tells me that it started and stopped a job and I send an event when both those things happen. I don't care when a container appears and disappears because it's what's supposed to do. It's an asynchronous job system. I care about the metrics it generates, but I don't care about it as an individual instance. That's a perfect example of Rieman, like where Rieman works perfectly in that sort of environment where hosts appear and disappear and are very ephemeral.
So you could have one central location, like a command center, I think you call it in your book, and then you can pass upstream all those whatever Rieman is reporting, right?
Yeah.
You're also covering CollectD, which you just mentioned earlier, right? And that collects statistics about the system. Is this something you use at Kickstarter?
We don't actually. CollectD, though, is very popular. I recently ran a monitoring survey, and it was the most popular. It was the most popular metrics collection tool amongst the survey respondents. It's a very, very lightweight, simple, written in C daemon with a plugin system that allows you to sort of monitor things, and it's very much about monitoring things and generating metrics from them. So it sits on the machine, doesn't take very much memory up, runs very fast. You can very easily say, its default assumption is that the endpoint you want to emit to is something that cares about metrics, rather than sort of the more traditional Nagios model where you really are in the Nagios sort of plugin API. The format of the responses are much more about status, and they do come with additional metrics data. But unless you do something specific with that metrics data, Nagios just discards it. Whereas this system is really to say, I care about a metric or a performance or something, a number that I'm somehow going to graph or do something with. I think that's a much more logical way of thinking about systems.
And so we can also use it with Rieman and do reporting that way.
Yeah, you can do Rieman, Graphite. There's a bunch of plugins that allow you to write to different destinations.
I think Rieman has some kind of graphical dashboard, doesn't it?
It does. So Kyle Kingsbury, who wrote Rieman, he wrote a thing called Rieman Dash, which is a very, very simple JavaScript-based dashboard. I personally think it's not awesome. I think Kyle probably admits it's probably not awesome. He doesn't claim to be a designer. But it's pretty simple and it works pretty well. I tend to think that there are some very good systems out there for visualizing metrics. Grafana, for example, has a really nice interface, and I can sit that on top of a number of different data stores. So I can send events from Rieman to one of those data stores, and then sit Grafana on top of them. I'd prefer to use a tool that's sort of best of breed for that. I think that the Rieman Dash product exists, or the Rieman Dash product exists so that there is a way to visualize stuff. It's not really, I think it's more a convenience than an actual sort of a solution that I would recommend sort of for complex dashboarding.
You also mentioned, or you're going to talk about Logstash in the book, if I'm not mistaken. What other kinds of technologies do you plan on talking about in the book?
So the book really is designed to take you through building that sort of a template architecture. So I'm really looking at setting up that central routing engine, looking at how I can monitor things on my hosts, like metrics and events at a sort of system level, how I can pick up and monitor logs, and then how I can pick up and monitor application and business metrics.
I see.
So essentially I'm trying to build an infrastructure that people can sort of build on top of. So each of those pieces I'm going to sort of lay out, and then I'm going to the last few chapters of the book will take a sort of an example environment with a series of applications in it, and show how you can use the infrastructure we've built to actually monitor things. I'm still not 100% happy about the sort of table of contents and how that sort of fits through, which is why it's going slower than I would like, and also, you know, my day job and things like that. Right. But and you know, I'm in the process of sort of finalizing what I think that will look like. I want it to be something where, you know, it's very hard to articulate both a change in architecture and a bunch of technical things. You want to try and tell a really coherent story, and that's not always easy to do.
I've got a few more questions about monitoring, and then we'll move on to Docker and also tie that in with monitoring as well. But there's a question from Alex Eats Kittens, which says, best practices for storing monitoring data long term. What do you think about that?
Well, it depends what the monitoring data is. I'm going to presume it means they mean metrics. And it depends on your volume. In most cases, tools like Graphite, which just basically write to flat files on disk, for most people, they scale pretty well. And I know there's people out there that that, you know, find Graphite doesn't meet their needs, but they're sort of generating millions and millions of metrics, and it sort of doesn't scale. For that, there's, you know, there are tools like OpenTSDB, InfluxDB. Mm-hmm. You know, there are tools out there who are specifically designed to consume metrics data and store it. I would say, though, that, you know, you've got to think about the lifespan of a metric and how long you want to care about that metric. For most people, you know, storing metrics for years and years and years, if it's feasible, is awesome, but how much value you get out of that. So you can make sort of compromise in the middle. You can say things like, I'm keeping a resolution. By resolution, I mean how the frequency of the metric, the frequency of the thing you're monitoring. Maybe I'll keep a 1 second resolution for 30 days. So I have like my the performance of my application to a 1 second resolution for a month, and then I degrade that and I say, okay, well, I'm going to keep resolution at 5 seconds for 6 months and resolution at 30 seconds for 2 years, and that sort of model is a way to sort of, because you know, those trends become smoothed out over longer periods of time, and you probably don't need that 1 second resolution 2 years later.
Mm-hmm. So James, I'm going to share a really quick little story about my sponsor, because I actually wrote a blog post very recently about error tracking, just because I want to help people get started with it, because it's helped me so much as well. And that way you can stop wasting hours of debugging in development, and you can also stop losing money in production from buggy code. You know, I had a reader come to me after reading that article, and he said, you know, debugging server-side JavaScript is okay, but client-side JavaScript is much harder. And I remember thinking, wow, that's so true. You know, in all my JavaScript development, I always kind of worked around that. I never tried to find a solution. And then I realized that I had found a solution, and that solution is Rollbar. See, when a client or a user runs into an error in JavaScript, Rollbar will catch that error, log it in your dashboard, and then send a notification via, you know, Slack, PagerDuty, or even email, just like we talked about with James previously. So go to try.rollbar.com/syc and set it up in 5 minutes. It's really easy. It works with any language you need and any tool you need. try.rollbar.com/syc, and also check out this awesome t-shirt they got me. This is how you spell it. R-O-L-L-B-A-R, try.rollbar.com/syc. All right, so James, what about Docker monitoring? Are there things that just work better than others? What are the best monitoring tools for Docker?
So there's a few different things out there. The very basic thing is that Docker actually comes with a command called stats. So if you run Docker stats, you will actually get sort of basic CPU, memory, network I/O, and a couple of other things for various containers. So that's a really good way to sort of see, you know, like immediately what's happening. The Docker Remote API also publishes metrics and statistics and performance stuff. So you can actually suck that out, like, and build some sort of interface to convert that into place. There's a few other different tools out there. that have sort of people that build integrations. So I think there's now the Amazon ECS, the container product, has a metrics module. New Relic has a Docker module. Datadog has a Docker module. Librato has a Docker module. And most of the sort of major monitoring systems, you know, things like Sensu and Nagios and stuff like that. So people have written plugins that allow you to sort of, you know, monitor the state of Docker. It really depends on your sort of requirements. I think for very basic stuff, you know, wrapping a simple script around the Docker API is probably, you know, incredibly cheap. Output the metrics as to StatsD or something like that, and then just collect them. If you want to look at sort of those metrics in the context of the, you know, other applications and services, then something like New Relic is probably or Datadog is probably a good solution, where you see your Docker container performance metrics juxtaposed with the sort of application metrics of whatever's running in the containers.
Mm-hmm. What do you think about Amazon's ECS containers, by the way? Have you had a chance to try them out?
Yeah, we've had a quick look at it at Kickstarter. We're a very big EC2 shop, or a very big AWS shop. So I'm always interested in the new services they build. I like it. I think it's missing some features from my point of view. It's not quite ready for prime time. You know, I find deployment with it is a bit, it's still a bit sort of clumsy. Job scheduling, job management, still not perfect there. But you know, it's like a lot of AWS products. The first cut is obviously them trying to sample the market.
Right.
But you know, if I compare it to, say, you know, obviously it's not in the same league as something like Mesosphere or something like that, you know, that's specifically designed for job scheduling and orchestration. But it's, you know, it's on the way there, and it'll be interesting to see how it evolves.
Mm-hmm. So I don't want to spend too much time on what Docker is and how it works, because I feel like there's already a lot of content on the internet that talks about this.
Should hope so by now.
But just in case people that are tuning in right now aren't very familiar with the technology, I don't want to lose them. So can you give us a general overview of what Docker is?
So Docker is a container virtualization system. So essentially it's a very lightweight virtualization system. It allows you to think about traditional virtual machines. They tend to be sort of take a lot of disk up, a lot of CPU, a lot of memory. They take quite a lot of launch because they really are very separate, very isolated machines. Docker containers are built on top of the Linux kernel. They're very lightweight. They use some Linux kernel features to construct. What you think about, I guess you could describe a traditional virtual machine as more like a sort of big brick house, and a Docker container is more sort of like a weatherboard, fibro, aluminum siding sort of container. So it's not as strong. You can punch through it a bit more easily. But it's very lightweight, takes up very little disk, very little memory, and runs lightning fast. So most Docker containers launch in sub-seconds, they're designed to be, very easy to use, and more importantly, they're designed to be built around a workflow. So Docker's original intent was to provide a system for a platform as a service that's called DotCloud. Which was a product that the Docker team used to run. It turned out to be really, really good at that, really good at that sort of workflow of, like, I have some application code, I want to package it up, and I want to ship it, and I want to run it.
Mm-hmm.
And that workflow is incredibly important to developers. You know, all developers know that, you know, every line of code that sits on their machine, rather than being deployed in production, is not making you money, it's not delivering any business value, it's not doing you any good. So the process of getting that code off your machine and into a production environment needs to be frictionless and seamless and easy. And Docker is a way to try and enhance that experience.
What is a common mindset that you've seen people that are new to Docker that really hinders them from understanding the technology? Maybe they come from a virtual machine background. Have you seen anything that a lot of people seem to think about, and it kind of makes it so they don't really understand how Docker works?
I think some people do think about Docker like traditional virtual machines, and there's a couple of reasons why that's problematic. One is that you know, Docker is much more lightweight. From a security point of view, you know, I don't think Docker containers are as secure as virtual machines. It also means you sort of think about like a virtual machine. In a lot of cases, despite it being sort of virtual, often a virtual machine will run for years and years and years, or months and months and months. Docker containers are very much designed to be ephemeral. They're designed to run for short periods of time. And really, they're not something, you're not likely to run a Docker container for 6 months. You're likely to run a Docker container for 6 minutes. Mm-hmm.
So let's walk through a very basic web app as a scenario, just to get an understanding of how we should be using Docker. So let's say, for example, I want to set up a single instance machine on Amazon. I have a web server, my database, and my app. How would I do that in Docker? Would I create separate containers for each of these services and link them together, have them communicate? Or do I build one bigger container and have all the services inside of it? How does that work?
Well, it depends somewhat on the complexity of the app, but I would tend to build separate containers for every service. There's a few things I get out of that. One is that if I want to scale that app, it's very easy for me to say I would like 10 web server containers instead of one web server container. Yeah. I can very easily add a container that is HAProxy or HAProxy. I also get a separation of concerns. If my web service goes away, I know that I just have to restart that container. I don't have to poke into the container to see which of the three services stopped, and I don't have to do things like restart a single container to get all three services to work in some way. So I get a separation of concerns. I get an easy to scale distributed architecture, and I get a really easy to monitor and represent service.
Mm-hmm. How do you have those different containers communicate with one another? How does Docker know what's going with what, et cetera?
So Docker allows you to a couple of different ways. One is that Docker exposes a series of can expose network ports, so it can sort of say things like, let's say your web server might expose port 80 or port 443, and then your application server, your database server might expose, you know, port 3306 for MySQL or whatever it happens to be. But you can also create links between containers, so I can do things like I can have my web service expose port 80, people all connect to the web service container. Then the web service container says, I'm a WordPress site. I need to go and get my database stuff out of my database. And it says, I have a link to the database container. It's container number one over there, or container MySQL one. And it goes off and uses the Docker daemon to find a route to that container. It's a private route. So it doesn't matter that no one else except the web service container can talk to that database server. There's no ports exposed. That container is completely isolated from anything except the container it's linked to.
Mm-hmm. Seems like I have read a few posts that talk about that and still see that as a security issue. I don't know, maybe if they get into the web server, they'll have access to all the variables for the database or something like that. How do you keep that secure, going back to the security issue you were talking about just a few minutes ago?
Well, there's two things to think about there. One is that security on containers is, and sort of at the application level, is no different from security on a virtual machine. Mm-hmm. Like if you allow someone to get inside a virtual machine through a web service and punch holes into the virtual machine and poke around in there, I don't see that as very different from
right.
doing the same thing in a Docker container. But I do think what's important to note is that a virtual machine has a far thicker set of walls between the sort of host operating system and the virtual machine than Docker does between the containers and the daemon and the underlying host operating system. So I tend to think about it's a good idea to run things like SE Linux or AppArmor on the Docker host, so the Docker server itself, so you can ensure that only those processes that are allowed to run, like Docker, for example, are the things that are running on that machine, and you'll get alerts or have it prevented. I also think you should run services of like security together. So if you're sticking your front-end web services on the same box as your back-end ERP server, that strikes me as a poor co-location of security concerns. And I would divide my workloads up into things of like security or like security level or like security type.
Mm-hmm. All right, so we have our containers in our instance now. How do you deploy code to it?
Well, it depends. There's a couple of different ways. One is that Docker containers are launched from a Docker image. And Docker image is it's a built file system. And mm-hmm. what happens is you can do things like, think about it as a tiny, tiny, thin operating system. just the bare pieces you need to run a service. So sure. I could do something like install Apache and WordPress and the WordPress PHP code base and enable PHP, and I can create an image called, say, you know, WordPress. And then when I create a container from that, it has all of the WordPress code and all of the stuff it needs to run a WordPress instance. So I can bake it into my image. So I can bake my source code in. Quite a lot of people, every time there's a new commit of an application, Jenkins or GitHub or whatever they're using to build their application, automatically rebuilds all the Docker images with the new update in it. Mm-hmm. And the idea is, because they are sort of relatively ephemeral, you just stop some of your containers and rerun them with the new image and the new version of the code. The other approach is that Docker has a very good system of being able to load file systems and mount points inside a container. So I can do things like, just like the mount command, I can say, inside this Docker container, mount this directory or this file system or this file share or this volume from a third-party storage system. And that file system might contain the source code for my application, or it might contain a checked out Git repo or something like that.
Okay. So if you don't want downtime, would you have to set up a load balancer, for example, and you take one container down and bring the other one up
at the same time? Assuming that it's something, it's an always on service, then yeah, sure. The idea would be that you'd have a load balancer and you would say, take, you know, classic mm-hmm. deployment stuff, take 10% mm-hmm. of the containers down, recreate them with the new from the new image with the new version, test that they work, and then do a rolling deployment from there. Mm-hmm. It's not a new it's not a new paradigm.
Right. So do you guys use Docker at Kickstarter?
We do. We primarily use it for local development, I'm sure in the future we'll expand that. That tends to be where Docker starts. Tends to start in local development mm-hmm. environments and end up in production.
I've got a question about that in just a little bit, actually. But so you use Docker at Kickstarter. You used to work at Puppet as well, Puppet Labs, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you guys use Puppet for Docker? Is that the recommended way of managing something like Docker files, for example, and getting all those booted up? How do you guys usually do that?
So I think a configuration management system like Puppet or Chef or Ansible is an ideal way to build and maintain the sort of Docker infrastructure, because you still need to manage all your Docker hosts. You still need to bring up those, you know, instances in right. EC2 or the cloud. So that's a really simple way of doing that. And I strongly recommend that for consistency, all the reasons you use a configuration management system, consistency and repeatability and compliance and enforceability, you know, that's a very good way to actually manage your Docker hosting environment.
Sure.
Many people also use it to build containers and build images and things like that. That's all an equally viable approach.
Mm-hmm. Well, here's a follow-up question from user ELYKQUENT. How do you recommend automating the management of orphaned volumes and orphaned images created during image development?
Yeah, interesting question. I'm not sure there's a good answer yet. And it depends what you mean by orphaned, I guess. No, I think my answer is I'm not sure there is a good answer. Mm-hmm. I think that you know, maintaining, you know, the tools like the Docker Hub and local registries allow you to store images and things like that. Understanding what images and what their current version is and their current layer or the SHA that they're using is probably. Probably at this moment still a sort of relatively manual process. I don't think there's an easy solution there yet.
Sure. Okay. Good question. So going back to production, there are people who believe that Docker is not really ready for production yet. And there's Simon Eskildsen, I'm sorry, Simon, if I pronounced that wrong, from Shopify, who wrote a post in July named "Why Docker is Not Yet Succeeding Widely in Production," and stating, among other things, that image building for large applications is still a challenge. And then he goes on to say, you know, Docker files make this almost impossible for large apps. He also says that logging is all over the place and there is no great generic solution. And there are a few other things he points out. And, you know, they've gone through a big ordeal moving Shopify to Docker containers. if people are interested, do check those out. There's a lot of videos on YouTube, etc. And I'm gonna send an email. It'd probably be a good interview as well. But anyway, my question is, do you see some of these issues, like the Dockerfile, for example, being too abstract to enable complex use cases and logging having no generic solution? Do you see these as solvable issues, or are these inherent to the technology and mission that Docker is trying to accomplish?
So I will say that I've read Simon's post. It's good, there is some great stuff, and I strongly recommend having a read of it. I'm not sure that the world has stood still since Shopify started. Shopify was a relatively early adopter of Docker, and mm-hmm. and the other shops that did sort of start adopting Docker, say middle of last year or something like that. There were some traumatic experiences. Like this is cutting edge technology, right?
Exactly.
I would not have recommended that, you know, you run a pre 1.0 release of Docker in production. In fact, every piece of documentation I ever wrote had a header at the top of it that said, "We do not recommend you use this in production." A significant number of companies, including Shopify, ignored us, which is awesome. Like, if they're prepared to be on the cutting edge, that's great. But with the cutting edge comes some compromises, mm-hmm. and that's in terms of feature and stability. However, the last couple of releases of Docker 1.7 and 1.8 are significantly more stable and significantly more featureful than previous ones. So, for example, the question of logging, Docker now comes with login plugins. You can do syslog and Guelph and Fluentd and a bunch of others. There are plugins for integrating with storage. There's a whole plugin architecture mm-hmm. being designed. There's better networking. There's better security. There's more stability. I would suggest, outside of very challenging environments and very complex environments, that Docker is quite ready for prime time. That being said, I also sort of challenge people when they say, you know, Docker's not ready for production for my highly complex app.
Yeah.
I would also say, what is ready for your highly complex app? If you're designing a complex multi-tier, multi-site, distributed computing application, you're probably designing a lot of your own tooling. There's not a lot of tooling out there that doesn't require serious engineering now, some serious right. engineering effort to get it running. If you're looking at Docker as a panacea in that space, you're probably not doing a very good job as an engineer.
Mm-hmm. So do you think some of these larger scale apps like Shopify, for example, using Docker, have they been able to contribute back to the core and help out iron out some of those issues?
I very much think so. I particularly want to shout out to the team at Gilt in New York and the team at Spotify in New York, mm-hmm. both of whom were very early adopters of Docker and gave huge amounts of feedback. I sat in numerous meetings with folks from both companies who were very generous with their time, mm-hmm. going, when are you guys going to fix this thing? It's terrible. But but providing really solid feedback on how they implemented things, what they needed, what they cared about. And there are a bunch of other companies out there who donated time and effort and in many cases contributed code. I mean, Docker's a hugely, huge ecosystem as an open source project. I can't thank those people enough. That they mm-hmm. they made the difference between Docker being successful and not.
That's awesome. Thank you, guys. All right, so just to wrap up Docker, running out of time here, what are some interesting tools and trends that you see in the Docker horizon, maybe the next year or so?
So I think the big things that are coming up, so Docker has two tools that have been recently added, relatively recently added. One's called Docker Compose, which is like how you can build multi-container, multi-tier applications very mm-hmm. easily with Docker. So it's a single definition file that allows you to say, you talked the example before about a web service, an application service, and a database. It's a very simple way of saying, here's how you build those three things together and link them together using one configuration file.
Mm-hmm.
The other tool is called Docker Swarm, and Docker Swarm allows, so that's a swarm. I have an accent, so it's a swarm, like beast. Swarm.
Sure, sure.
It's an orchestration tool for Docker. It allows you to run Docker in multiple distributed environments. So previously, Docker hosts didn't know about one another. So if you had containers running on one Docker host, they didn't know about containers running on other Docker hosts. Docker Swarm provides that capability. It means you can deploy multi-tenant, multi-geography distributed Docker environments, you know, transfer containers between hosts, spin up certain containers in certain data centers. And that's very early days, but I think that's going to be really fascinating. And the other thing is that the plugin system around Docker is going to enable you to be able to integrate Docker with a bunch of other tools, storage systems, logging systems, networking, software-defined. This is a huge thing in the sort of software-defined data center world. And that's going to be really exciting stuff.
They also just came out with a toolbox that makes it a lot easier.
Yes, I should have mentioned the brand new early in the week Docker toolbox, which combines the Docker client, Docker machine, which is a way of provisioning Docker hosts, Kitematic on OS X and Windows, which is a GUI interface to Docker and the Docker registry. It includes the Compose tool on OS X, and it includes VirtualBox and a running Docker server. It's really great. It's all out of the box. It's one single command to install all the pieces you're ever going to need as a local development environment and get started. Thoroughly recommend people check that out if you want to get started with Docker.
Yeah, I'll put a link below the video, and I'm sure you could Google it really quickly as well.
Yeah, I also just to throw in there, I wrote a book called The Docker Book. An update will come out this weekend that includes all of the 1.8 and Docker Toolbox updates. So probably come out on Sunday, depending on how much sleep I get on.
Very nice. So if people want to stay in touch with when The Art of Monitoring is going to come out and that update to the book, how do you recommend they do that?
Yeah, so the www.dockerbook.com has basically that tells you about the latest release and has all the errata. Also has a mailing list you can subscribe to, has links to buying the book and what's new and changed. And on the www.artofmonitoring.com, there is a link there for a mailing list you can join, and I'll be sending out updates about that about the book as they appear.
All right. So, James, do you have a few minutes, or I know we're about to run out of time here?
I do have a couple of minutes, yeah.
Okay. Just got a few more questions about Kickstarter, and I'll let you go on your way. So what do you do in day-to-day operations as a VP of engineering? What does your job look like?
My job is largely a leadership function. So I'm really there to ensure the team has everything it needs to build awesome product. And has the right number of people and the right tools and the right process, and my job is really to facilitate them being awesome as being engineers and data people and designers and ops people and all that sort of stuff.
Mm-hmm. What would you say was one of the hardest challenges that you guys have worked on?
I think probably for us, Kickstarter is a very established service. It's been around 6 years or so. We have a very passionate community. Building software for passionate communities is hard. You want to build something that's going to delight them and make them really happy, make them engage even more strongly with the product. But they're very used to a product that looks and feels as ours does. And so you want to build things that are also tasteful and elegant and seamlessly provide them with this is a much better user experience, rather than sort of things that are disjointed and are surprising to the user. You want them to be pleased, not surprised, I guess. I think too, we're rapidly growing. The team has gotten bigger, but also the traffic and the size of the projects on the site.
How much traffic do you guys get?
I'm not sure I'm allowed to quantify that, but let's put it this way. Earlier this year, the Pebble project raised $20 million. We have projects that have tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands to even millions of backers. So if you imagine that's, something like Pebble, that's several hundred thousand people simultaneously hitting, clicking back, for an indication of the sort of scale we're talking about. And that presents challenges. We've obviously got to scale the site out in a sort of in as seamless way as possible, and in a way that ensures our user base and our community has an awesome user experience.
Awesome, James. I really appreciate your time. And I was going to compliment you on the, I guess, the wine bottles in the back and the gun, the handgun. That is a pretty cool handgun.
it's actually from Hellboy. It's Hellboy's.
Oh, okay. I thought it looked kind of familiar.
Yeah. Cool. I'm not otherwise a gun person. It's a movie memorabilia as opposed to a functioning. Certainly in New York City, definitely opposed to a function. otherwise, I'll end up with a SWAT team down my neck. So,
well, great. So, guys, check out both of his sites, or all his sites. I know you've got multiple different sites for the art of monitoring and the books. You've written so many different books, and I do want to give you a shout out. I saw somebody else on Reddit comment about this, but I really, really believe that you're a very good author. Just when going through your different books, sometimes when you have authors, they write different things like this and they don't really expand on the details. So they'll show you configuration or something and just kind of skip out on some of the important details, but you don't, you always walk through step by step. So thank you very much for putting out such great content, James. And thanks again for doing this interview. I really appreciate it.
No, thank you. It's really been good fun. And I really appreciate the compliment. It's what I aim to do is try and build books that are really simple and people can learn from and grow from. And some people are going to find those simplistic, but I think that it's important to explain the basics coherently and simply.
I agree entirely. Thank you all for watching. Make sure you leave a comment. Let us know what you learned from this interview and to thank James. Thank you all for watching.
Thank you very much. Have a great day.